Hi, everyone. This is Lauren Steiner. Welcome to this edition of The Robust Opposition. I am so thrilled and honored to have this guest with me tonight. I've been following her work for years. It's a little bit of a departure from the topics that I generally cover, but I would love to welcome to my show Dr. Gail Dines, who's a professor of sociology at Wheelock College, and and women's studies at Wheelock College in Boston. And she has been researching and writing about the porn industry for well over 25 years. Can you imagine? She's an internationally known speaker and consultant to government bodies, both here in the United States and abroad. She has been described as a leading anti-porn scholar activist. Her latest book, Pornland, How Porn Has Hijacked Our Sexuality, has been translated into 5 languages. She is the founding president of the NGO Culture Reframed, dedicated to building resilience and resistance in children and youth to the harms of a hypersexualized and pornified society. Gail is also the consultant for the forthcoming film, Tsunami, The Destructive Forces of Pornography, produced by one of my favorite Hollywood directors, Steven Soderbergh. Gail, welcome to our show.
It's a pleasure. Thank you for asking me to be on.
So I want to ask you the first question. What do you mean when you talk about the pornification of our society?
What I mean is basically the images, the ideologies, the representations, the norms and values of pornography, which is basically about the debasement and dehumanization of women, get filtered down into mainstream pop culture. So we're all kind of saturated in this pornified culture that tells men that they have a privilege and a right to own and abuse women's bodies.
Yes. So, you also mentioned in your talk that pornography is the major form of sex education today.
Absolutely. I mean, all over the world. It's the great democratizer. Wherever you can get a cell phone, you get access to pornography. And it's interesting that when we think about pornography as a business, like we should, not as a collection of images, there's no accident that much of the pornography, for example, much of the cell phones were actually developed by R&D money from the pornographers, because what they did was they put money especially into the actual screen so that you could see the porn more clearly, because they realized that parents could monitor kids if you had a laptop in the middle of the room or if you had a computer, but you could really not monitor them on a mobile phone. So the pornographers have been very involved in developing the technology of the mobile phone, as they were involved in developing the technology of the VCR, as they were in developing the technology of the internet. So it's not just today that the internet or new technology drives pornography, it's that pornography drives new technology and gives a ton of money to the development of it in ways that will help promote the porn industry.
And you have said that there are more visitors to porn sites than there are to Amazon, Twitter, and Netflix combined?
I haven't said that. That was the Huffington Post who did an article that was looking at the number of people who go to pornography. Yes. So, and also there's a ton of research coming from different methodologies that show about a third of the internet, whether it be downloads, traffic, searches, has been cannibalized by the porn industry.
Now, how is today's porn different from the pornography of our generation? Because I remember, you know, Hustler and Playboy, and I even remember, you know, the video stores where you had to be over 18 and they had the movies in the back room. What are we seeing today that's different from back then?
You know what? I never thought I would live to say that those were the good old days, that I'm nostalgic for Playboy, Penthouse and Hustler. Hustler was as bad as it got. And that was awful. And the sexism that was in Playboy and Penthouse was terrible. Today, however, the average boy who first looks at porn at 11, according to studies, is catapulted into a world of absolute sexual degradation, violence, humiliation. I mean, the images that are mainstream, and I must stress this, mainstream free porn images through the free porn sites are the very images that today, if you wanted them years ago, you would have had to go to a specific shop, to go to a specific part of that shop, know somebody, and get that level of hardcore imagery. That is mainstream today.
Yes, and can you describe, I mean, I've warned people that there's going to be graphic language, not graphic image, because I cannot roll in a video. Can you just describe your term gonzo porn, what some of those videos are about?
Okay, so the term gonzo actually came out of kind of a first person image, but how the porn industry uses it as a shorthand is for those scenes, they're not really films, that are just basically about sex, wall-to-wall sex, very, very hardcore, and they're really formulaic. I mean, because pornography is an industry, it's formulaic and generic like all industries. I mean, when you walk into McDonald's in the UK or the US or Italy or anywhere, you get exactly the same hamburger with exactly the same fries. That's what porn is. It's a generic formulaic type of product. So the main scenes you'll see in most free porn sites are gagging women with a penis till literally they're vomiting, choking, and for a bit of extra fun, they'll often hold her nose so she really can't breathe. Very, very rough pounding anal sex. And in pornography, anal sex is really about delivering to the woman just what a filthy, dirty slut she really is. And there was an interesting film done in Australia where they interviewed a really hardcore producer, director of anal porn. And he said, the great thing about anal porn is you can't fake it, it's real. And what he meant about that is you can't fake the violence and the pain that's being done to her. Another very popular act is ATM, ass to mouth. That's where the penis goes into the anus and then into her mouth without washing. Standard image is 3, 4, 5 men, you know, 2 penises in the anus, 2 penises in the vagina, 1 across her mouth, pulling her hair, spitting in her face, calling her a whore, and then ejaculating all over her face. That is standard. I don't go near the worst. I mean, kink.com, for example, which I would say is very much about the torture of women. I don't even go into that.
Now, you told me that you often go to these pornography conventions and you talk to the owners of the pornography manufacturers, and they tell you, Gail, it's not us, it's the viewers. They want more and more. They get inured to what we're giving them, so we have to up the ante. And you talked about one scene that was just frightening to me, where they actually had a woman's head in a toilet bowl, like they were waterboarding her, and they were, you know, penetrating her anally at the same time.
The pornographers love to do, there's a couple of things that when you go to the porn conventions, the first thing you find out is none of them are pornographers. They're all artists. The one over there is the pornographer, but they always say, I'm an artist. So you meet all these so-called artists. So when this guy told me he was an artist, and I looked at his film that he was showing, it was a woman kneeling in a coffin being anally penetrated. That was his art. So, I mean, when you go to those conventions and you speak to these guys, it's very interesting the way they have a story to tell that really does try and blame the fans and the men. Let me say, I do not think men are born woman haters. I do not even think they're born seeking out this level of violence. I think what's really interesting is that these men are socialized by the porn industry to want this level of degradation. It's the same as all capitalist industries. Do you think we all came out of the womb looking for a McDonald's hamburger? I mean, our taste is socially constructed through the main industries of capitalism. Pornography is a major form of capitalism today. It is global capitalism. It is all over the world. It is in all the banks. It interfaces with all the major venture capitalists, with all the major corporations that you can think about. So I really think that we have to look at how pornography is creating this misogynist taste in men, as opposed to assuming that men automatically are misogynists and seek out pornography. They certainly seek out pornography, but they do so at an age that typically developmentally they're interested in sex. We have this ridiculous notion in this country that you don't teach sex education. Where else are you going to go? You're going to put porn into Google.
And you gave a very poignant talk in your TED talk about what happens to these, you know, 12-year-olds when they go. Can you repeat that story?
Yes. Let me tell you what's really interesting. And I have to say, the reason I came to this was because when I was writing my book, Pornland, and was really steeped in pornography, and I could barely stand to watch it. And I would I would be looking at it like this. And at one point, I was thinking, you know, what would my son, when he was 11, have thought of this? Why don't these boys run screaming from it? And so I really started to delve into the way in which they advertise the pornography, the sort of little things they put on the side of the imagery. And what they say are things like, are you man enough for this? Can you cope with this? We're giving you what you want. And when you think about the average 11, 12-year-old who's developing his sexual template, his sense of masculinity and patriarchy, what 12-year-old boy is going to say, no, 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 I'm not man enough for this. I can't deal with this. I can't stand this. He is actually being pulled into the porn industry, much like a spider lays a web, and then they pull the fly in. And so what's happening here is I think your average 12-year-old, let's just go through what he's thinking about. He puts porn into Google. What does he think he's going to see? Maybe breasts, maybe vaginas. Do you think for 1 minute he's going to see a woman being gagged with a penis till she can't breathe and she's choking? I don't. But he's being told, you want this. We know you want this. And I think in his stomach is a toxic mix of arousal, fear, self-loathing, and shame. And I think he's actually being traumatized by these images, as indeed, the more you watch, the more traumatized you become, because you're watching a form of sexual abuse and violence. Now, what we know about trauma is that if you do not deal with it, and of course, how is the 11-year-old boy going to deal with it? Because who's he going to speak to? Then you keep going back to the site at which that first trauma happened. And of course, that would be the porn site. So actually built into their business model is an addiction model, which is brilliant for pornographers, terrible for the culture, terrible for boys, terrible for girls, terrible for the entire society, but brilliant if you're a capitalist working in the porn industry.
Yes, now let's get into that. Now, you call it the biggest underreported public health epidemic out there. So in order to say why that is, please talk about the mental, emotional, and physical effects that watching too much porn or being a porn addict can have.
Okay, so let's begin with the fact that there's 40 years of empirical research coming out of experimental psychology, social psychology, sociology, communications, medical journals. So what we're talking about now is peer-reviewed research. So anyone who argues that pornography has no effect is clearly totally unfamiliar with the research. We know it has emotional effects. We know it has social effects. We know it limits their capacity for intimacy, connection. It often ruins what they think should be a sort of connected sex life. They don't know how to develop relationships. They expect to have erections for an hour, give their hookups or girlfriends screaming orgasms for an hour. And often it just ruins the whole aspect of what sex is because it builds up expectations. And also we know that it makes them less empathic to rape victims. It can turn them into women haters. It's linked to violence against women. It's linked to erectile dysfunction. It's linked to addiction. You know, there's just, we could go on and on and on the effects. And they're across the cognitive, the social, the emotional, the sexual effects. And when you speak to young people, what's really interesting is, you know, I often speak at universities, but I'm also now speaking at a lot of high schools as well. And you speak to these kids and you say to them, what is it like growing up in a porn culture? And when they realize there's somebody who's going to listen without being judgmental or shaming, you then start to hear the stories of how just fed up with all of this they are, how they feel like they've been thrown into this porn culture. They've been left to navigate it through them all on their own and that they are drowning in it. The girls and the boys say the same thing. The boys want to get away from the pornography. They can't stand it. The girls feel completely overwhelmed by the boys that they're hooking up with who want porn sex. So, you know, it's not helping many people in that way, certainly making a lot of people rich. And I do think there has been a mass dereliction of duty on the part of adults to bury our head. I say this is the biggest public health, really stealth public health crisis of the digital age. That's what we say at Culture Reframed. That's why we're building programs for parents and professionals. How is it possible that the biggest, you know, sex ed corporation in the world is absolutely not talked about? And indeed, you know, I got involved with this film with Steven Soderbergh, and that was his question to the director. explain in your film why nobody's talking about pornography, which is reshaping the entire sexual template of boys all over the Western world, and grown men, of course, but boys, and more importantly, because their brains are still developing, and we know that when you look at porn, it really impacts the way that your synapses fire and wire together.
Yes, let's talk about that, because I've read that, you know, these porn addicts, they could have the most beautiful wife or girlfriend, but they still can't get off with them, because why?
Well, we know from the medical journals, and this is what's interesting, is when you want to look at the research, you have to start burying deep into all the journals because it's scattered everywhere. So since they've been following, for example, erectile disorder, it's been for ages around 15 to 25, it's been at a steady 2.5%. Suddenly, since 2010, it's jumped from 2.5% to 27%. Mm-hmm. Now, either there is a virus going around, and it just so happens that 15 to 25-year-old boys are catching this and getting erectile dysfunction, or we have to look to the culture. And as a sociologist, of course, I go to the latter. And I was just recently giving testimony in Capitol Hill, and I was around some great young men, all of whom were porn addicts, and who now run porn sites like NoFap by Alexander Rhodes, Reboot Nation by Gabe Dean, all of whom were porn addicts. And I was listening to Gabe Dean talk about his experience becoming addicted at porn by the age of eight. By the age of eight, spending his entire teens as a porn addict, talking about the fact that, you know, you can maintain erections with porn for an hour and a half. You get with a real woman, you're lucky if you manage to maintain an erection for 2 minutes. Now, I just want to say to some of the male viewers listening to you, is what I'm saying doesn't mean that this happens to everybody, right? In social science, it's very important to remember that we're looking here at causation and correlation. Not all men who look at porn and boys are going to end up like this. There's going to be a continuum of effects. What I can say is that there is no way, no way that you are going to walk away from porn unchanged. Whether you end up the addict, or whether you end up the one who can't develop relationships, or whether you just have a kind of really warped view of your own sexuality, your own penis, women's bodies, whatever it is, you are going to be somewhere on that continuum. And that's what's very important for men to hear, because a lot of them can say, well, I've never raped a woman, I would never rape a woman. That's probably very true. Might not be true for some of them, but it's probably true for many of them. Doesn't mean to say you've not been affected by pornography.
Now, as a woman, I'm also concerned about the effect of young girls. I was reading an article, these Australian girls were talking about how, you know, they're just automatically expected to give these blowjobs, and they don't get anything back, and they're just so tired of it. And, you know, it's really interesting because I was down in San Diego for a Democratic Party meeting, and we all went out in the gas lamp district. And I swear to God, I thought I was in like the area where you go to pick up call girls, because every single young girl that was out that night was wearing the short skirts, the tight tops with the breasts exposed, those hooker platform shoes. And I was aghast. I mean, there's so objectifying. I mean, that's, you know, you and I are both wearing makeup here tonight. We don't think there's anything wrong with trying to look attractive, but trying to look like a hooker as a
matter- I'd say a prostituted woman, not a hooker, a prostituted, because I think we should talk about what happens to that woman. She's not a hooker. She's, something has happened to her, which is being prostituted.
Yes. I wanted to get into the concept of the sex worker versus the slave. And we're going to be getting into that right away.
Can I just answer your question, though? You just came up with something really important.
Okay.
I think when you think about what is on offer to our girls today, they have two choices. Either they're fuckable or invisible. And when you think about what fuckability looks like today, you know, like you just described it, the short skirt, the very high heels, the midriff showing, the low top. I mean, if you are at that developmental stage in adolescence where you need to fit in, which is really what the DNA of adolescence is about, what are you going to do when all your friends are walking around that and are visible, that and their visibility is due to how they look fuckable? How are you going to ask a 13-year-old girl not to conform to that and to buy into invisibility. It is too much to ask of her. And then I don't think we should start blaming them. I think what we need to say is, what kind of a culture are we where we offer young girls two choices, fuckability or invisibility? You know what women want and girls want? We want a life. We want a sense of self. We want integrity. We want to have work that is fulfilling. We want to live a good life just like men do. And yet what we are forced into is looking in this plasticized, roboticized, what I call the Stepford slut. You know, our mothers had to be Stepford wives. Your daughters have to be Stepford sluts. Both are produced through capitalism to serve the needs of men. And of course, all the corporate industries that go to produce that.
Yes, let's segue into that, because viewers of my show know that I'm fighting neoliberalism. It's a particularly heinous form of capitalism that has been around pretty much since I graduated college in 1979, and it even may have started under Jimmy Carter. Between World War II and about 1980, as workers' productivity increased, their salaries increased along with their bosses. The CEO made five times the average worker, not 500 times the average worker. And since 1980, everything stopped. The average wage has remained the same if you adjust for inflation. And, you know, if you listen to your Marxist, you probably have listened to David Harvey, who has that video, The Crisis of Capitalism. And he's like, in the war between labor and capital, labor used to win, and now capital is winning. And why were they able to do that? Because of credit. Because of credit, people are able to live like they can't afford to live. And then, of course, when you have busts, like the housing market collapses, it all falls apart. And then you're left with the fact that now we have, you know, the most inequality, which actually increased the most under Barack Obama. We have inequality levels not seen since the Gilded Age. Yeah. But neoliberalism being specifically the idea of the privatization of public goods. So I've been focusing on the privatization of education, the charter school movement, the privatization of our public lands, the privatization of fracking, of the postal service. And this is just another example of the privatization. Now, I wanted to, you may want to talk more about this as it relates to pornography, but I wanted to talk about how the other topic that we're going to discuss in the second half hour, which is how feminism has changed from collective liberation was the goal, the liberation of women as a group to
as a class,
to individual empowerment.
Exactly. Well, let me begin with the sort of neoliberalism, because this is something I'm really interested. You know, neoliberalism is the perfect ideology to legitimize capitalism, and especially predatory capitalism, because it's all about being an individual. You know, there's that wonderful saying from Margaret Thatcher, there's no such thing as society, only individuals. Well, you know what? That's true for poor people. It's not true for rich. Those who form the sort of predatory class, they act as a class. They know full well when they get together at Davos and when they get together in all of these areas, they're acting collectively as a class. The only ones who are supposed to think there's no such thing as a collectivity and that we're all individuals are those of us who don't have that kind of economic power. But believe me, those with economic power, they act with collective interest. Now, they might not always mesh as they do now with what's happening with Trump, where you're having the fight between the Trump types and the hedge fund types. There's actually a battle going on. But the actual overarching thing about neoliberalism, which is so perfect for capitalism, is it atomizes individuals. It makes you feel alone. It makes you feel isolated. It kills the, you know, you talked about the fact that workers now with credit, we also have to add into that the destruction of the unions and all the union movement. I mean, my university students don't know what unions are. I have to explain what a union is. You know, I grew up in England where the worst crime you could do was cross a picket line. I mean, it was just considered the absolute worst thing. My students, a lot of them don't know what a picket line is today. So, you know, we have changed so dramatically, and it's not accidental. I mean, when you look at the think tanks that develop, you look at right-wing talk radio, this is swamping us. And now we don't have to begin talking about Trump and Bannon. That's even can't tolerate going there. So neoliberalism has taken hold in a way here that it actually doesn't often take us hold in Europe to such a degree. Now, it's also taken hold in the feminist movement. I joined a feminist movement that said very clearly, I might have skin privileges. I might be doing fine. You know what? I am. I have the skin privileges of being white. I have race privileges. The only thing I don't have is gender privileges, but I do have class privileges and things like that. But you know what? That doesn't mean shit for the woman who comes and cleans my classroom when I'm done at 4 o'clock teaching. My privilege is actually built on her back. I joined a feminist movement, the radical feminist movement, that said that if that woman over there, if she is not empowered, or rather, I should say, liberated, then I have to walk that distance. What we have today is an individualistic based, what they call third wave feminism, which is all me, 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 me. I'm empowered. Fuck you. If I want to watch porn and I'm empowered by that, fuck that woman over there who has to go and, you know, work in porn for no money, get her body destroyed within a few months and then end up walking the streets of Nevada. Fuck her, because I get this all the time when I go through the college campuses. But I like my porn, and this is from women. I'm a feminist and I'm allowed to watch porn. And it's like coming up to me and saying, you know, I'm a progressive person, but fuck the people who work in the sweatshops, because I really enjoy wearing my Dolce & Gabbana. You wouldn't say that if you were left. But this is incredible what's happened to feminism. And I have to say, when I go and I lecture all over college campuses, the most neoliberal today, and I can't believe I'm saying this because it makes me want to cry, the most right-wing, reactionary, neoliberal responses I get around pornography and prostitution are mainly from those who have studied women's studies. In sociology, political science, American studies, there's still more of a progressive bent to the subject. But women's studies seems to have completely capitulated to neoliberalism. And the arguments that we often have, like the arguments around prostitution. What's wrong with prostitution? They're sex workers. They're not sex workers. They're prostituted women who live in forms of sexual slavery. And you know what? Women who call them sex workers, and often women in the industry who refer to them as sex workers themselves, when they get out and they've had time to reflect on what happens, they don't refer to themselves as sex workers. That's what you do when you're working in the industry, having to survive the daily assault of being raped by Johns. But when you speak to women who've gotten out of the industry, and I work with many women who have, there's a great organization called Space, which is mainly made up of exited women. They would never refer to themselves in a million years as sex workers. They were exploited. They were raped on a daily level, which is what prostitution is, and it's sexual slavery.
Now, you also talk about how many of these women are, you know, they come from abused, they were abused by their fathers or their stepfathers or some male. They come to Hollywood looking to be an actress. They can't find work doing that, so they get roped into the porn industry, and then they get used up. Tell me about that. Tell the viewers the conversation we had about that and where they end up.
Well, often what happens is, you know, when I first started this work 20 odd years ago, you could say, you know, of the vast majority of women in pornography were raped and were abused. That is actually not true today. I would say that there are many who are kind of trafficked into it in a very sort of stealth trafficking, which is a boyfriend who kind of reels them in, saying, you know, you're so hot and you give sex away for nothing. Why don't you pay, you get money for it? So there's always a boyfriend somewhere that suggested that this would be a good idea, always somewhere in the back of the picture. Of course, there are still the women who've been abused who are in porn. And also, we have the media to blame for this. We have Pretty Woman. I mean, that ridiculous movie of Pretty Woman. We have the glorification of pornography and prostitution everywhere. Let's just think of this young girl living in the Midwest looking at a lifetime of minimum wage. And then some guy suggests, you know, Jenna Jameson, she got really rich on this. Sasha Gray, she got really rich on pornography. Why don't we try it? Let's get on the bus to LA and see what happens. And then you know what? It is very easy to get into pornography and prostitution. It is way more difficult to get out of pornography and prostitution. And what often happens to women in pornography is they're used up within 3 months because their bodies simply cannot tolerate the torture that is happening to them on a daily basis on the set. And they end up on a very short bus ride to the brothels of Nevada.
Right. Now, back to that sexual, the collective liberation versus the individual empowerment, kind of puts me in mind of that Sheryl Sandberg lean-in feminism that is talked about, you know, that was all about the elevation of that individual woman within her, you know, career or
CEO job, within her CEO. I mean, remember, if you're a cleaner and you lean in, you're going to get fired.
So Margot Tenenbaum was a fellow Bernie delegate, actually, in Philadelphia, and she writes this.
Well, let me tell you, I have spent years working with exited women. I have yet to meet one who has been out of the industry who said she loved it. I am sure when you're in the industry, you're going to say all of those things. I mean, I was recently on this panel at the UN with one woman who's an exited woman, and she said, if you would have asked me when I was working in prostitution, I would have told you I was empowered, I loved it. She now runs one of the best exiting programs in the Northeast. So this is why they're in the industry. You've got to wait till they get out of the industry. I don't buy that these women love it. I refuse to accept it. I know too many women. I've heard too many stories. And anyone who thinks that needs to read Rachel Moran's book, Paid For. And then they need to rethink what it means to be actually paid for and destroyed by a John.
What is the solution here? You aren't saying that you think pornography should be banned, are you?
Well, I don't know what that means today in the age of the internet. I mean, that's the word ban is a 20th century term. What I do think is I think the rights of women, to make a joke, trump the rights of the pornographers. I think women's civil rights absolutely trump the rights of the pornographers to create a form of imagery that is misogynist, that is destructive, and that is going to rip apart our society. So I don't think we can ban it. What I would like to see is some of the stuff that's going on in the UK around opt-in, opt-out, or age verification. I would like to see what Iceland was talking about when the left Greens were in power. They were talking about defining pornography as a violation of women's civil rights, because in the Icelandic constitution, it is written that women and men are equal, and that pornography basically goes against that constitutional argument, because you cannot have women and men equal in a society where men have access to hardcore porn that dehumanizes women. I come from that position. Pornography dehumanizes and destroys the civil rights of women, and our civil rights matter more than the profits of the pornography industry.
Well, it's interesting because this kind of reminds me of what's called the rights of nature argument that a lot of people are trying to use to ban fracking. When they try to actually get fracking bans, the industry invokes the takings clause of the Constitution, that they have the rights to exploit the minerals. You know, they have purchased the rights to the minerals under the land. And even if the person who lives on the land doesn't want to give them the rights, they have the mineral rights. When you're bringing up a rights argument, I think maybe you do have some legal leg to stand on. But I will tell you that I was in Cuba. And they don't have a lot of pornography there, mostly because they don't have the internet or there isn't widespread use of the internet. And we got to meet some very high-level people in the government, including Mariela Castro, who is Raul Castro's daughter, and she is in the parliament. She is also a sexologist. And she was telling us that when they teach sex education in Cuba, they teach about relationships and intimacy and the rights of women. And they don't just focus on how to prevent pregnancy. So do you think that a solution here might be just, you know, a different type of sex education in the schools?
I don't think, when you think of massive social problems, there's not one solution. I like to call it the Gulliver strategy, where you tie the monster down, you know, piece by piece. Do I think a robust sex education in the schools would help this? Absolutely. I mean, it is ludicrous that we have no sex ed. And I would like to see about relationship ed, intimacy ed, also talking about gender education. I'd like to see gender deconstructed in this kind of education as well. And what is masculinity and what is femininity under a patriarchal society? So yes, I would like to see that. And I think it would help. Would it solve the problem? I'm not so sure. The reason being that when you mix sex and violence as you do in pornography, the hit to the body is so powerful that it's very, very hard to resist for young boys who are growing up in this patriarchal age.
Now, as far as you know, do they have any kind of treatment for this? I mean, we have treatments for drug addiction, for alcohol addiction.
Oh, yes, yes. Absolutely. There's no question. There is a lot of treatment programs. What I want to say, I think it's really important here, is that it gets them off porn, because I've met a lot of men who have been through these. But I think we need to add on a feminist analysis and to ask what exactly are they getting addicted to? Because we know that they're not getting addicted to Playboy or Penthouse or softcore porn. They're getting addicted to the regular gonzo porn. And I think it is that mixture of sex and violence that makes it so addictive. And I think it is the image of men in absolute and total control over women that is causing part of the addiction. So it's not just enough to get so-called off the substance. What you have to do is to rethink how pornography has given you an ideology of patriarchy and male privilege, and to really get into that and deconstruct that and think about how that's impacted you.
I watched your talk at the Left Forum that you did last year, and you mentioned something about this all changing when gender studies replaced women's studies. I wonder if you could speak to that.
Well, that was one example, is that, you know, women's studies, a lot of women, great feminists, worked really hard, really, really hard to make it women's studies for a reason. So it was feminist, it was focusing on the history of women, all that has been taken away from women. When you make it gender studies, you take women out of the title. And that's what's happening today. I mean, you go to a lot of gender studies, or they're called gender sexuality studies, and a lot of them has got virtually no feminism in them. Not what I would call feminism. I'd call it more faux feminism. The old women's studies that I was brought up in, the more radical, really, I couldn't imagine that I would be attracted to feminism today if I was in a lot of these gender studies programs. They're not that interesting. They don't give you that sort of shot in the arm of the idea of liberation. You know, I think many of us who are progressive can remember that first time when you really understood what oppression was, how your life had been shaped by it, and how you had an alternative. I mean, I remember first reading Andrea Dworkin in a coffee shop in London at 18, and like, I couldn't move. I was just stuck there. And I couldn't imagine many books coming out of gender and queer studies and sexuality studies today that would leave me sitting there completely, you know, just in a stupor of, I have been looking for this my entire life and I didn't even know it. That's what I remember thinking when I read Andrea Dworkin.
Can you address this question?
Well, I mean, I'm not quite sure what they mean. Well, first of all, I think we all should be non-binary, right? The whole idea of a binary system, if you've got masculinity and femininity. The feminist project was to argue that both are socially constructed. They both lock you in a cage. And what I would argue is that we all need to get away from this and not buy into the binary system. It doesn't help anybody. The notion that you have this thing called masculinity and this thing called femininity that has very distinct behaviors and attitudes attached to it is all socially constructed. It's all a product of a system in order to subordinate women. So I think we need to go see way beyond that and think about getting rid of gender altogether and let people be what they want to be, instead of forcing them into these, you know, constructed cages that I don't think fit anybody.
I did too notice that there was some democratic progressive pushback because this idea was coming from the right. Yeah. And yeah.
Let me tell you, this public health, this is such a joke because the whole public health issue, actually, I wrote about in my book Pornland 6 years ago before any Republican had really heard of it. And it really got going under the left Greens in Iceland. So actually, because the Republicans picked it up, I don't think they really understand what public health is. And remember, if you're going to have a public health campaign against pornography, it's got to come with a really good sex ed program. I can't imagine these people agreeing to a sex ed program. So I think this is a distraction that the Republicans have picked this up. This is not what we're talking about. We're talking about a public health program that is progressive, that is feminist, and that comes with a really robust sex education program. And I wouldn't be waylaid by that just because some Republicans have mentioned it.
So maybe you could close with telling us about Culture Reframed, anything that I did not address in the show tonight, and how people that are concerned about this issue can get involved.
Our goal is to build resilience and resistance in kids to the porn culture. And the way you do that is that you basically build capacity in parents on how to help their kids build resilience and resistance to pornography. What we have found is that parents really don't know what's going on. And if they do, they certainly don't know how to have the conversations. So we are going to develop a whole curriculum starting from scratch, which looks at how parents can discuss and partners can discuss pornography, how they discuss it with their children. It's going to be related in terms of it's going to be developmentally appropriate for different groups, early adolescence, middle adolescence, late adolescence. It's going to have a whole cornucopia of things attached to it, PowerPoints that you can download for free, that you can give in your local communities, toolkits that come with it. We're also going to build programs for health professionals where they can get continuing education units looking at the impact of porn. What is amazing is how few therapists, pediatricians, nurses, people who you would think would understand the impact of pornography are clueless. I gave in October the keynote at the American Academy of Pediatrics, which is a big thing, 3,000 pediatricians. And let me tell you, 10 years ago, I would never have gotten near there. The fact that they asked me to be one of on the plenary session tells you that they're seeing this in their practices. We need them to understand the impact of pornography. We need them to understand that when they're looking at this kid who looks like he might have teenage angst because he hasn't left his room in days, could very well be a porn addict or getting into trouble with pornography. We need to build capacity in parents, professionals, in order to build resilience and resistance in kids. That is our philosophy.
Now, what about pressuring the advertisers? Because in your TEDx talk, you show some pretty bad, you know, photos and the magazine covers, and you're shaking your head. You don't think this is going to work?
Well, let's put it this way, and this is a quote that actually I gave in a talk in Canada, and it's kind of taken over Tumblr and everywhere. I see it everywhere. And I said, you know, could you imagine what would happen if tomorrow women all over the world woke up and loved their bodies? You know, global capitalism would collapse. If you think of how many industries are based on the fact that women loathe their bodies, from the fashion industry to the makeup industry to the diet industry to all of those industries, I mean, you know, advertisements is just part of a whole mechanism which gets us to hate ourselves, to buy products that are, you know, you think about it, women in the West are buying products made by poor women in the global South who can't afford these products. I mean, global capitalism in many ways sits on the shoulders of the privileged women in the West with the products being produced by women in the global South. I mean, it's so astounding the degree to which I hear people talk about global capitalism and don't really understand the way in which women are at the center of that. And actually, Bill Moyers years ago did a great show on PBS, really looking at how you take women out of global capitalism and it's gone, it's collapsed. And it's not just as consumers, but especially as workers as well.
I think that one of the reasons that Hillary lost, aside from the fact that she was a terrible candidate, hated by the extreme left and the right, was that she ran a campaign based on identity politics and fear of Trump. And it was an anti-establishment year, a populist year. And both Bernie and Trump ran on that platform. So what I'm finding right now is in the effort to kind of unify after this election and bring the left back together, one thing that I've always advocated for, even before I knew who Bernie Sanders was the left getting out of their issue silos. Because what happens is we've got the environmentalists here and the women's reproductive rights people there and the dreamers here and the Black Lives Matter people there and the, you know. So we need to work together because we're going to be much more effective if we can unite. But what I'm finding right now is some pushback still coming from the extreme left. And these are people who want to insist on, you know, and I'm not saying when they insist on it, it means that it's not true, but talking about white privilege all the damn time. And whenever you say, yes, it exists, I acknowledge my white privilege, but let's talk about economic inequality and how we have
it's a great point.
Yeah, and they want to, they throw, well, you're just saying that because of your white privilege, or you're just upset because of your white fragility. And I just find it so counterproductive, and it's kind of...
I completely agree. I completely agree, because let me tell you, we talk about this a lot in my classes, and we read some great stuff, especially, I don't know if you've read any of Studs Terkel's stuff about poverty-stricken whites in the South. And now, when I think about some of my students, and certainly race, you cannot eradicate race from the issue. If you're a person of color in this country, you're really screwed by the white system. But let's be very clear. If I turn to my white students, many of whom have got three jobs, first generation, no money, and turn around and say, you're privileged, all I'm going to do is enrage them, because they don't feel privileged. They're exhausted, they're wiped out. And so in my classes, I always say, we cannot talk about racism outside of talking about capitalism. And you cannot talk about that outside of talking about sexism. And this is where the left, I think, needs to grab back the concept of intersectionality from identity politics and make it a material issue and not an identity issue. That unless we understand the way in which capitalism works, and when you talk about white fragility, what do you say to the white single mother who's got three jobs, right, works 20 hours a day to put food on the table for her children, hardly sleeps and keeps everything together? She's not fragile. She's a fucking hero. OK, so I think what we've got to understand is when you talk about white fragility, make sure you put it on the right social class, right, which is the wealthy. And instead to understand that actually when slavery developed, the goal of the slave of the white slave owners was to separate the white indentured servants from the black indentured servants and create this new category called slaves that only African Americans sat into. And what they offered whites was not money, but what they called the wages of whiteness. You weren't getting any money, you weren't getting any land, but we promised not to make you, quote, black. What we have to do is we have to understand so importantly that unless we come together as those of us who do not have the power and the privilege of the elite and figure out a way to be non-racist, non-sexist and anti-racist and anti-sexist and also have a material analysis of capitalism rooted into all of that, then we're lost. We're going to end up fighting each other for the crumbs that the capitalists throw us. I'd like to see us all come together and figure out a way that instead of eating each other alive over whose identity politics is more important, is take a materialist understanding of how this country is being destroyed by a small percentage of people, indeed the world, not just this country. And that really, to be honest, how much time do we have given what's going on with climate change, global warming? I mean, we really are up against the clock here. And I tell you, I have a son, you have kids. You know, we've got a vested interest that this world is around for them and any kids that they have. And this is what scares me. This is what scares me. There's a point at which there is no pulling back around. We haven't really gotten into the climate issue. But I mean, you know, you want to think about things that make you not sleep at night? Think about what's going on. I mean, you know, the right don't talk about climate change or say they'll deny it. They know full well that this is going on. They're developing maps of where it's going to be flooded. They know that. I just want people, I want to see people have what has kept me going as an activist for 30 years, which is a slow, controlled, burning rage that social justice has to win out. Not a rage that will eat you up, destroy you, make your life miserable, but one that will propel you to fight for justice. That's what I ask for people.
Well, that is brilliant. We've reached that time when we need to end our show. I will say goodbye to you, Gail. Thank you so much.
Thank you for being a guest
on The Robust Opposition, and I hope to have you back again.
It was a pleasure, Lauren. Thank you so much.
This has been Lauren Steiner for The Robust Opposition. See you next time.